Well, I think we could consider to get going. So after lunch and a short break you may have had, I welcome you to the afternoon session. There has been a morning session on data management, which I could unfortunately not attend. So in case there is a red line of discussion which comes already from the morning, maybe some of the participants would like to advise me on that, then we could eventually continue. But for the time being, I would say we just get started with this afternoon session. From the list of presenters and from the titles of their presentations, I can see that I would say all the presentations, but the first one, are clearly putting their presentations also in the context of Inspire and what Inspire could have to do with data management, how this will change data management or vice versa. I think being somebody who is with a team engaged in the Inspire governance, we are in particular interested to pursue this topic, and I'm hopeful that we find through your presentations also some elements of this, and maybe we have the opportunity to have a little piece of discussion here in the session. So with this, I would like to almost get started. So my name is Stefan Jensen. I'm leading a group which is actually called Data Management these days in the European Environment Agency. And there we're working on Inspire implementation, and we're working on Copernicus Land in particular. There's a lot of data, especially also from the Copernicus side coming, so we're facing those issues. Regarding the presenters now, the gentleman who is first on the list does not seem to have appeared so far, Mr. Vai. So if this doesn't seem to be the case, so then I would propose that we start right away with Nicolas Regnault. He's product manager at OneSpatial in the United Kingdom. Most of us know OneSpatial as a very engaged company in the area, so I'm curious to hear from Nicolas what he would like to share with us on data management aspects. Nicolas, the floor is yours. For the presenters, as a rule, we should have a little bit under 15 minutes for the presentation, and then we go into some questions and answers. Okay. Let's get started.
Thank you very much. So my name is Nicolas Regnault, and I am product manager at OneSpatial. So OneSpatial is the company that focuses on developing software to manage large geospatial databases, and we are used to working with organizations like mapping agencies, national mapping agencies, who have to handle large amounts of them. So during this talk, I will speak a bit about the challenges that some those organizations are facing, and then I will move on to introduce three of our products that we are using in the context of the European location framework, which is ongoing at the moment. So geospatial data more and more underpins many applications, many services, and ultimately many decisions taken in lots of different areas. We've got applications in the kind of utilities, in all the electricity lines. We have applications to do some simulation of flooding, or lots of routing, lots of responses to emergency services. So all those applications tend to require different things from the data. So more and more mapping agencies need to be able to respond to different types of demand. And it's difficult. There is no more that one-fits-all strategy. That's not possible anymore. Mapping agencies need to be able to adapt their products to the requirements. And through that, there is one thing which is always essential, which is the quality of the data delivered. So mapping agencies need to have quality data at the start to be able to derive quality products for their customers. The tricky thing is that quality means different things to different products, or to different applications, I mean. Some applications might be more concerned about the up-to-dateness of the data, others about the positional accuracy, whether it will be more about how well structured the data are to be able to do some routing. So basically the key is to have data which are fit for purpose. And that's not easy to handle. And basically there is always more and more demand on new type of applications, and therefore new demands on the geospatial data. Like here we've got an example of 3D data, 3D modeling. The gaming industry more and more likes to have applications on real world data or augmented reality. So demand keeps coming. There is still always a need for geospatial providers to come up with new ideas, new products. And then there is the need to move towards standards and harmonization of the data, because we see more and more applications and services coming about to exploit those data. But still, the situation at the moment is that in different countries, you'll find very different data models, sometimes very different ways of structuring the data. And that means that for application developers, it's very difficult to, once they've done a service that works for one country, they'll find that they do need to do an awful lot of rework to be able to make it available in the next country. So that probably means that there is lots of cases where there is just simply some application which never gets developed just because there is not enough return on investment possible with that model. And that's one of the reasons why there is that effort of harmonization and standardization of the data across Europe led by the INSPIRE directive. And there is that European location framework project which is ongoing at the moment, trying to exploit or use those directives to try to build an harmonized portal of data across Europe. And another thing that producers like mapping agencies are facing all the time is pressure on the budget. Most of them are government organizations which keep seeing their budget reduced. So, to summarize, really, organizations like mapping agencies need to be able to get more out of their data, do more diversity of products, and be able to respond to the changes in the market. They need to do that in a more efficient way, using more automation, and importantly, make sure that throughout those process of deriving of capturing the data and deriving products from it, the quality gets kept under control. So at OneSpatial, we've been working with those agencies for many years now, and we've come up with that suite of products which is designed to help mapping agencies improve the efficiency throughout that process. So we've got some products to help them planning the capture process, to actually do the capture process with OneEdit here, and also to manage the database itself with a big emphasis on the validation of the data to keep it always conforming to a set of business rules. And then we've got a suite of products here to exploit the database once you've got the data in a good shape. We've got a product to automatically generalize the data to get products at multiple scales, or one integrate is more for either fixing automatically some quality issues in the data, or to import to conflate information from different data sets and bring information from one to others. OnePublish is a high-end cartographic styling product. So in this presentation, I'm going to focus on three of those products, which are OneValidate, OneIntegrate, and OneGeneralize, because these are the three that we are using in the context of the European location framework. So those three products are rule-based, meaning that they are driven by rules which the user can edit. They can write the rules they like, and the software will basically check those rules and do either generalization based on them or validation. So that really is about automating and speeding up the process without constraining too much a user, so that they still have the control over what is checked and over the rules, and then the software does the kind of repetitive hard work. So let's start with one validate, which is the one which is used to check that your data conforms to a set of rules. So basically you will edit, write those rules and check your data against those rules, and the software will tell you exactly for each rule how many non-conformances it finds, and it can also show you where in the data you've got problems of non-conformance. For the European location framework, we propose one validate as part of it's a cloud, an application in the cloud, so you can see it here. It's a cloud platform, and there is a set of rules which have been run on a data set, and it will give you the percentage of conformance for each one. And if you click here, it will get you to an XML information that will tell you exactly all the cases of non-conformance. So then we've got one integrate, which is more about data enhancement usually. It's using the same rule framework than one validate, but instead of just detecting a situation, capable, once it's detected one situation, to attach to it an action, like a corrective action if you've got a problem which has been identified, or a kind of a conflation action if it's what you want to do. So here is an example of what we do with it within the ELF project, which is cross-border edge matching, knowing that you've got the red lines here between the red line being the boundary between two countries. There is a kind of buffer around it within which you're going to do the edge matching, and you're just going to try to find cases where the connection is not right and force it to so that it matches on both sides. Well, this is a series of very simple examples, but there is some much more complex ones which we've been working on. And one generalize is our latest, our new automatic generalization software. It's flexible and ready to use generalization system, which is a big change between what we used to provide and what you'll probably find in the industry at the moment, where usually you find big tool set and you have to work, put those tools together to write your own generalization solution. Here we try to have something which out of the box works and is able to work in a national load mode, meaning derive a full map series for the whole country, or also work in incremental update mode, meaning when there is some change in your source data, only propagate that change to the target dataset. So that generalization software relies on quite advanced database, object-oriented database capabilities, explicit topology, multi-agent system multi-agent system to do some optimization. And also the rule-based processing language that we've seen earlier. Important as well is that the fact that one generalize is very customizable. So it comes with a predefined flow line that can quickly get you using that generalization on your data. But then, of course, that flow line can be entirely customized, can change the rules, change the parameters and everything. And you can, yes, so everything in there can be tuned by the user. And more importantly, that system is production ready. So generalization is available as a service that can be integrated into a much bigger system, kind of workflow system. It's scalable and resilient. It can make use of a grid of processing nodes. It can split the space and do parallel processing with it, which makes the process scalable because you can always add more nodes to process faster, but also make it resilient, because if anything fails somewhere, it will only be a little part of your data which needs to be rerun, the rest will still be valid. You won't have to redo a national load a second time if one little thing fails in the middle. And as I said, it's available in national load mode to do your first cut of a new product and after only incrementally update parts of it.
Can you start concluding?
Yes, okay. Slowly? So one generalize is used for ELF for two different flow lines, one which is for creating ELF Master 2 database, but without cartographic generalization, and a second one with a cartographic generalization added to it to do 50K maps. So just to summarize, one SMS provides a set of tools to capture, maintain, and publish spatial data. And there is a strong focus on quality, efficiency, and flexibility, which are the key things that large organizations which look after geospatial data are concerned with. So yes, we've mostly developed this for national mapping agencies, but we also have other types of organizations using these, like defense organizations, hydrography organizations, utility companies, etc. And we use our product at the moment in the context of ELF to help with your harmonization process which is going on. So thank you very much for your attention. And I'd like to point out that we have a stand on the exhibition area, and we'll be most happy to give you more detail about any of those. I can give you a demonstration on one generalize if you like. So please come and visit us. Thank you very much.
Thank you for your presentation, Nicolas. Can I invite one or two questions from the audience? I would have one though. You presenting this in this Inspire session. So when I look at the three areas, generalize, integrate, validate, I could only kind of sense Inspire in the validate area. Please, how does Inspire influence your product generation, your work of data management? Where have you introduced what out of the Inspire set of tools and recommendations?
But it's as you said, mostly on the validation area where we have developed some rules to validate the data against the Inspire data model.
NX1, NX2, or all the NXs?
Sorry?
NX1, 2, or all the NXs? Or which NXs are you validating against?
Oh, I don't know that much into the detail, but I know that we've got guys who look at that and develop the right ones. And we use as well the same data models, the Inspire data model, as a base to generalize data as well. With the ELF.
Well, seems to be the question. So thank you very much, Nicolas. I invite then the next presentation. The next presentation is by Anas Fourreau. Anas is a project process manager data feeds and data hosting at CEPA, the Swedish Environment Protection Agency. And Anas will speak about quality control service for Inspire Data. I'm curious.
Yes.
The floor is almost yours.
No sound? Like this. Can you hear me? Even if I walk? Still hear me?
Yeah.
Okay. My name is Anders Forå. I work in the Swedish APA in Stockholm. Have anyone heard me before last year in Aalborg, for example? One? Okay. This is like a follow-up what have been done since last time. I work in managing processing of data from creating data until anyone can use it. And we have a long history of that. We started even before the authority existed. I think the oldest measurement is from 1965, and I think some of the authorities have even older data sets. So it's a long history of monitoring, but it's also time consuming. And I will first tell a little bit about how we have arranged the environmental monitoring in Sweden and try to connect it to the Inspire theme, Inspire community. We have lots of contractors, very many private consultants on the county level, and each contractor is supposed to deliver the data to data hosts. 1994, we invented this data host concept that said that data should be stored as close to the source as possible, or as Inspire says, or where it's most efficient. And for a few years, we have developed a validation tool. And since last year, the new water authority is with us. It's placed in Gothenburg, and they are running the water framework directive and the marine directive work. And I will show you some of the ISO standard that we picked up from the Inspire domain and put it in the environmental monitoring domain. So I will talk a little bit about the background and the data flow, and I have promised in my abstract a live demo, and I can see I have connection to internet, so I hope for the best. Right, 200 consultants or more are collecting data, short contracts or long contracts, 290 municipalities and 21 counties. And this makes it quite difficult to manage this. Now we have two central environmental authorities. It's the Swedish EPA and SWAM in Gothenburg since 2011. So the problem, it's a very time consuming and manual quality assurance process, and the data hosts are often forced to fix things that the submitter should have been fixed for perhaps months or years earlier. So that's not fair, because the contractor of the in the field has already got paid for do his job, and he should do that completely. On the consumer side, so we have got some complaints that takes much too long from the collection of data until it's public on the internet, published on the internet. And it's very hard for the end user to find relevant quality information in where they find the data. There are definitely quality information, but it's spread on several different web pages. So the point is to speed up the data flow, check the quality online against quality specifications and quality measures, and create metadata on the fly, and gather all the requirements in one piece of paper called data product specification according to ISO 19131, if you're familiar with that. So if we can save time for the experts, they can do much more qualified work instead of creating incomplete data files. And as far as possible, use the same standard. So this is the basic of harmonization to the Inspire. If we use the same standards and schemas and so on, so it will be much more easier for end user to pick up the environmental data and the Inspire data and mix it together. It's like building a car. This is not rocket science. The red lines is what we have focused on. Cut the data flow into small pieces, find bottlenecks, and focus on the most time-consuming processes. The next last bullet, reuse software. We have found some excellent softwares that we are interested in. A few years ago, we checked where are the data hosts putting their efforts and time. And we found out, after going through 130 different data flows, that they put about 30% of their time for taking, receiving data and manage for before they can get it in the database. And almost the same amount of time to wait a minute. So, almost the same amount of time to get it out on the internet in some usable formats. This is the this is overall process. It's not rocket science. Data comes in from the left, of mostly in Excel formats. We are XML guys in Sweden. The first thing that happens in validation service is that it translates into XML according to a data specification and observations and measurements. After that, the validation process takes over, and out comes data and a specification compliance and metadata according to 19.139. And at the end, the data host gets the package of files and can put it in the database much more quicker, because now he or she knows exactly what's in that XML. We try to connect to different other services out there in Italy or Denmark, doesn't matter. And now I'm going to switch to this one. I forgot to push my timer. Have you got?
I'm.
All right. There you are. So, okay, I had really opened it. There it is. It's not the most coolest web page you have seen, but it works. So now I'm going to test with a file that I know for sure it's incorrect. I will tell who I am and where I work and my email and what type of media is, and of course the data host, the email to the data host. After doing that, I click on the start button, and hopefully this is so something will happen. The machine behind this is FME engine placed in Luleå, something we call the cloud, but it's not up in the air, it's down on the ground. And now it's checking all those files, lots of files, in a spreadsheet. If everything is, well, what it's supposed to be there or not. I have, okay, let's see. And I've stressed it all the morning here, so I got the files. I can't try that one. We take this one who is not working. You see, I have a jammed mailbox, so perhaps it has something to do with it. This is a result when the file is incorrect, and there's a link to a web page. Says something about how it's going or not going.
Uh-oh.
Okay. It's something Swedish eBay issue here. Ah, of course. I almost checked everything. Except for this little. Okay. I come back to that if there is any time left for me. I will show what happens later. It was, I ran out of the time for my email because I haven't been emailed for a few minutes. Anyway, what we have focused on is the observations measurements, which are referred to in the environmental monitoring facilities specification. It's an open standard, and decisions must be made from us. We are trying to find a core in the model, and this is the core, very, very, very overview. When we are coming to the specific data types, we have to define everything. For example, what kind of gear is this? This is an Ekman sampler, where you can hand it from a Zodiac boat, or a huge Gemini sampler that goes down to the bottom and picks up cores from the sediment. So we have to define everything in the data model, and when it's ready, we have come so far, as you can see here, for air quality metals and hazardous substances in sediments. I'm almost finished with those types that are mainly the swarm authorities' business. We will focus on those types that are consuming most of the data host's time, and when we have a scale benefit of doing this. We will not do it for exactly every data type that you can imagine. We are looking close to some excellent softwares that GRC has developed. This is the registry for code lists for Inspire. You can download it and you can implement it on your own place. So we are thinking of perhaps have a clone of those softwares. And this is actually what we have done with a data dictionary that EA has been running for about at least 10 years. They have put all the codes that they need for validate all incoming international reportings, and we are doing the same. We have got it from GitHub, it lies there. It's open source, everything. We have put about 3,000 parameters, concepts in this for chemical, biological, and physical measurements. This is, for example, nanoparticles that, you know, the small guys, buckyballs, can it follow in the coal, the very interesting coal molecule. New for me, but they are there. Hopefully we can have some collaboration with the EA according to this, because we will not do exactly what EA are doing, but I don't think that EA will handle all the EU countries, all possible code lists from 1965 until 2 years, forever and ever. This is another supporting service. It's a WFS service in the cloud. It's our second pilot, based on OpenGS Suit from Boundless, and in the platform from Microsoft called Azure. It's mostly by pedagogical reasons. If we have these supporting services, apart from the not built in some other system, we can handle it more smooth, I think. This is under development, and so where's the data? I've just discussed the incoming process. So here's one of the data hosts, the Swedish Geological Survey in Sweden. You can get it from the map. This is a web map, but they're also available by web map service. And you can go to the open data entrance and get all those news if there are any new data incoming, so you can get these at-home feeds. And different formats like JSON and CSV. And next step for us will probably be to set the stamp version 1.0 for this validation service. And the same with the station registry, we will finish it next autumn, I hope. For a sustainable management of all the national codes in collaboration with GRC and EA. And get away from the Excel swamp, because it's quite a hassle to handle all those Excel files. So if we can get the data right from the analytical laboratory in the machine readable format, it will be much easier. But that forces us to rethink a little bit But hopefully we can get away from the Excel. And Swan in Gothenburg is now a partner for the development of the version 2.0, I hope. This is some of the specifications or standards, I mean. So if you are familiar with Inspire, you can see that it's the same. Yeah. This is more of the standards. So that was it.
Super. Thank you very much, Anas. Unfortunately, we cannot return to the live demo.
What's
just? Unfortunately, we cannot return to the live demo now.
Yeah.
We rather have some questions, maybe from the audience. Do I see?
If there are technical questions, we have Lars Burman with us from the company Metria that has developed this service in the back end.
Can I engage the audience here with a question? I'm still digesting the lunch. I can make a comment. You referred to our data dictionary and to use that as a registry or so. I think we are in the move of developing this with partners. So I'm happy to hear that you're also interested to cooperate in this, because we see that while there's the Inspire registry as the JRC, we have also for the environmental reporting data flows, we maintain the data dictionary, which has data elements and XML schemas, but we want to also introduce some registry function, which could indeed make sense to have it there, but we need to develop this data flow by data flow, identify what are the cost lists, what has to go in there. So I will refer to the colleagues, if you have not the context already, who are interested to work on that, and in particular, under the Inspire perspective. We have ourselves, as of today, not an Inspire type registry yet. So we are also only starting with that now, based on our plan to support semantic implementation.
I was in a workshop in January 2014, and then I met Sir Rogue.
I think that is a trigger, and so, let's continue on that. That's excellent. Okay.
On the screen, Gemini. I put the Gemini X in the file, and that would respond an error. That was one of the errors. The other was the media sediment with an uppercase S that would also give an error back to me. So that's the essence of the demo.
Well, okay, thanks once more. We're moving now to Poland, to Monika Oksiuta. Oh, now I'm not doing well. Oksiuta? Dzień dobry. And she is from the Institute for Meteorology and Water Management, part of the Ministry of the Environment. And she will speak about a database they are maintaining on meteorology and water, and with some reference to Inspire. And she seems to have a co-presenter. Maybe the co-presenter likes to introduce himself, and it's for you, the floor, in a second. So this is Piotr.
Good afternoon. My name is Piotr Kozak, and with my colleague Monika, we represent Polish Institute of Meteorology and Water Management. We work in the database center, and we have 15 minutes together, so warn me please if I start reaching the half time. One of the most important duties of the Institute of Meteorology and Water Management is, following the Polish law, is to organize National Hydrological and Meteorological Service. The service consists of four systems: it's the measurement and observation system, next data transmission system, which provides transmission of the measured data. Next, the data processing system, because we measure, take the data in the moment of the time. Yes, but sometimes we have we have do something. We have checked the mean, for example, mean daily temperature or extreme mass, and next data and product distribution system. I will concentrate on measurement and measurement system and data and distribution system. The measuring and observation system consists of six or more small systems. The biggest and stations which has have the widest widest range of observations and measurements are so-called synoptic stations. And there are 62 synoptic stations in Poland, 38 the first order, which have 24 every hour observations, and around the clock observations provided by automatic automatic apparatus and contracted staff. The program is measurement program is quite wide because we take data as starting from the most popular as temperature and rain data, following snow conditions, temperature of soil on for the visibility, duration of sunshine, etc., etc. It's an example of the synoptic station. The third and fourth order, there are stations, climatological stations, which have shorter program. There are 200 stations of third and fourth order. The most important measurements are temperature and rain. Excuse me. The climatological stations could be equipped with the automatical measurement device or contracted staff, which measure three times a day all the parameters which we take from the station. And the last order of meteorological station are precipitation stations, which only measure data related with precipitation, rain, snow, ice is a snow depth cover, and next the data is transmitted to the database. It's an example of precipitation station. In hydrology, we have water grid size. There are a map of water grid stations of four different orders. The station have different range of measurements and observations. And there are also weather radars which transmit data in near real time to the European maps of clouds and of rain possibility. And we also have eight stations of detection of atmospheric lightings, where we can see what kind of lightning or other atmospheric phenomena there are near to the station. The data in the real time, or let's say near real time, are provided to the operational database, and every people can see the actual or almost actual state of atmosphere and hydrosphere. For example, we can choose one of the station. We can choose some region, one of the regions of Poland, or introduce the name of the station, and we can see the four hydrological station, water level from three previous days, water discharge, and for the meteorological station, the precipitation volume from last hour, from last 22 days, and last 7 days. We can see the changes in time, these parameters. We can also see air temperature from automatical station and measured by the observer.
Half time is coming up. Half time.
Okay.
You asked for.
So after this is operational database, and next is historical database. Historical database. In the historical database, we have data from last years, which are checked, and after all the corrects we sometimes should introduce to the data, we collect it into the historical database. There are some metadata, but it's not big amount of metadata, because we have in the institute especially dedicated system to the collecting metadata and changes of metadata of the stations, and we have some historical data, hydrological mean and extremas of level, water level and runoff, information about the ice cover, and some meteorological information. And the database is very useful and very user-friendly, but it's quite old version, and it not fulfills the INSPIRE requirements. So we have to introduce some changes and some changes into database. So I give the place to my colleague.
Thank you for giving us the basis.
Hello, my name is Monika Okshuta, and I tell something about modification of our database, which prepare them to realize INSPIRE directive requirements. The modification consists of addition of new types of stored data. It also is a connection of data and metadata from a few separate references system on one side. We also have a new functionality of viewing data and a new functionality of downloading data and metadata separately but or together. We also have a new way of security of permission for data, and a new way of distribution data for the clients. We could archiving new kind of data like VOMO, messengers, meteorological and hydrological warning messages, aerological measurements and other. We also are keeping scans of old journal of observation and metadata of measuring station and also metadata of measurement devices. Viewing data is similar in two parts of a database, CBDO and CBDH. And they have the similar data but different function. In CBDO, database is the nearly real time and data which is used to giving meteorological forecasts, for example. And in the CBDH part of the database, we use this data to give some prediction, for example, about climate changes. And there is a list of kind of data which we could view in. We have access to data which is consists of grants and data slides. Data slides is a free object which is described by a list of station, a list of classification and time period. A grant is a type of data permission and is described by data slides, type of data permission, for example, to reading data or to export data. And of course, it also have a login of user. And this is visualization of grant, for example, to reading data. And when the data slide is inside grant, it's everything okay. We could view this data. If this data slide was outside the grant, we couldn't view this data. We could viewing data using by data slides, and the data slides should be as big as possible, but we could for a normal use narrow it by selecting station, select classification or select time period. We also have tools called restriction expression, and we could select, for example, one month which was interesting. And that is data with restriction expression. There's a screen with semi-annual data, and we have some kind type to search data. This is this data. Loading data is using also by data slides, and we have very useful tools called expect frequency of measurement, because we could prepare a report of expected data and downloaded, really downloaded data, and give this kind of report to our client. Data export is always done to a CSV file, because the Excel files could be too less to collect all data from one export. Modification about metadata is consists of storage of metadata of a station from one reference system, storage of metadata of measurement devices from other reference system, and connection the station metadata and metadata of measurement devices and correct data. And the connection is possible by using a new database object, measurement channel, and the biggest modification about metadata is a new way of downloading data and metadata separately or together. We have nearly 200 defined metadata, and we could search them by 29 search criteria from three classes, by metadata of measurement station, measurement tunnel, or measurement devices. We could export, as I say, metadata separately, and this export can be done to a CSV file or XML file. And this is export metadata. And we also could export metadata and data together. We could select a metadata slice which is similar like a data bar slice, or we could select a type of metadata one by one.
Can you start wrapping up?
Okay. Super. This is our current data base, which I have part with data and part with metadata of session, but this metadata of a copy from a reference system. We a modification in and we add a new type of stored data and a new functionality. It's automatically actualization from a reference system. But when we we need to change it because Inspire Directive is so we get the another one modification and we modification part of metadata and we add a new type of metadata. It was metadata of a measurement device, and we also get a new functionality of road landing metadata. But it's not enough to realize Inspire Directive requirements. We have two important questions. How to harmonize our data and metadata to implement Inspire Directive by ISOC system, and how to download data with metadata together. And we get a conception of measurement channel. And after this conception, we have step three of modification, which gave us a new time of new metadata, metadata of measurement trend, and new functionality to running data and metadata together. This is a database which is will be connected with part of ISOC system dedicated to implementation of Inspire Directive, and measurement channel is the part of our database which connected it. In part of ISOC system have table with metadata mapping on Inspire parameter. And by using the measurement channel, we downloading data and metadata to harmonize it. And there is harmonized data. And after that, we could share this data according to Inspire Directive, and it is the finish of our work. Thank you for your attention.
Thank you, Piotr and Monika. That looked like a lot of work you have been doing there. Other questions to both of you? So you found that beneficial to introduce Inspire, or what would you call the benefits in brief, in two sentences?
We have the kind of data which is we have we can get the data or metadata to the public, yes, because our current database is only for internal use.
Okay.
Yes, and this device can allows us to
publish.
Get, and to give to publish the metadata to the people.
Well, thank you very much to both of you again. We have a little change in the program. Instead of Mark Hogerwerf, we have a presentation now by Rüdiger Gartmann from Conterra. Now Rüdiger will tell us if the topic is the same or how that changed. We'll find out.
Yeah, thank you. So basically, the topic hasn't changed because we've been co-authors for this presentation anyway, and just Mark wasn't able to come here, so I'm here talking on behalf of him. So Mark is with the Trans-Adriatic Pipeline, and we are working together on a couple of projects. And a very important topic in there is data sharing. And so we thought it might be interesting to give a kind of, let's say, commercial view on the data sharing aspect, because basically within Inspire, data sharing is always something, something for the official data providers, for the national data providers. But it's also very relevant for public companies, especially when working on such a large project, such as a pipeline. And the title is Data Sharing and Access Control, a contradiction question mark. So basically it sounds like a contradiction. So what do you want? Do you want to share data, or do you want to restrict access to data? Sounds like something in opposite. But in fact, it is not. For a company like TAP or Trans-Adriatic Pipeline, it's even kind of a prerequisite in order to be able to share data at all. So let me start with a brief introduction to the Trans-Adriatic Pipeline project. So it's a pipeline running through three European countries like Greece, Albania, and Italy. It also crosses the Adriatic Sea. So as you can see, it touches at least three national different jurisdictions and even more different regulations on regional and local level. So it's quite challenging in terms of questions like data sharing. But on the other hand, data sharing is really a need for such a project because it's very vital to inform the public about what's going on, where the pipeline shall be located, about questions like environment protection and something like that. So it is important to inform the general public about what is going on, but it's also important to be able to protect certain aspects of the data for not being able to be seen by everybody. Looking at this pipeline schedule, so we are now in 2015, and which means the project is already running for a while, but it's just right now starting with real building stuff, and the first thing which has to be built is something like access roads and bridges and something like that to the real trajectory of the pipeline. So pipeline building hasn't even started, but a lot of things are already going on, starting with land acquisition and something like that. And the real building of the pipeline will take something like 1.5 years at the end. And in 2018, the first gas shall be delivered through this new pipeline. Looking at their kind of system architecture, we see that something like an enterprise GIS system is kind of a foundation for all of their different business aspects within TAP. So we don't have to go into detail here, but it's already obvious that there are many different business issues which all have to deal with something like GIS information. And of course, all these different business issues have, different need for different kinds of data. And it's also crucial to give all of these different aspects different views on the data. So nobody shall be able to see every information because there's also, restricted information in there. But it is necessary that all these internal parts of the business are getting access to the enterprise GIS system at the bottom. Well, talking about the data sharing requirements, there are lots of contractors and subcontractors building that pipeline. So it's necessary to share something like building information. So where has the pipeline to be built? What is the trajectory? What are building details of the pipeline? It's also necessary to somehow maintain information about the work status of the different contractors. So are they still in time? Are they having delays and something like that? How does the whole picture fit together? About planning information, for also for the contractors and the subcontractors, that they get some kind of a full image of what has to be done, and to enable them to fit their work into the whole picture. And as I said, there are three different countries touched by this pipeline, and you need to share data with officials of these countries in order to get approval for the pipeline track for something like land acquisition, expropriation, compensation aspects. So how much compensation do landowners get when they need to give their land away for this pipeline project? And of course, there's, as I mentioned before, there's a public interest in issues about the pipeline as well. But there are also restrictions. So there are restrictions by law, first of all, very tough restrictions on personal data, which are which prevents sharing of personal data of inhabitants of one country to officials to another country, for instance. So that has to be ensured that officials can access data about their own citizens, but they can't access data of citizens of the neighbor countries. And of course, personal data doesn't or must not be disclosed to the general public. I'll give you an example of these kinds of data sets afterwards. Well, in addition to these restrictions by law, there are also commercial restrictions, of course. Of course, the different contractors have an interest for not sharing all the information about their work status and potential delays and potential, let's say, contract issues and so on with other contractors. They might be competitors among each other, and so also a certain level of security has to be ensured. And of course, something like financial information between the different contractors. It's also something which must not be disclosed because, this is all negotiated individually, and I think it's obvious why this shall not be shared. When we're looking on the onto the TEP data protection policy, there are first of all three different classes of data. So first is something like non-personal data. So data which doesn't relate to certain persons or certain identifiable people. This is basically not a problem. So this can be shared openly, and we don't need restrictions for that. Then we have a class which is called personal data, which covers all data which is related to identified or identifiable persons. Something like ownership of land parcels and something like that. And we have a third class, which is called sensitive personal data. And this is data on something like religious or political activities, on health, on social security information, on criminal information and something like that. And this is even more sensitive than the regular personal data. When we look at such a data set, in the green part, we have some kind of non-personal information, which is, for instance, the ID of a certain land parcel and an ID for the owner. So it's just an ID, it's not a name. But when we add the name, first name, last name is in the middle part, this is already personal information. When you have access to this kind of data, you can derive who is the owner of a certain parcel and so on. And this is already information which has to be protected by law. So it's nothing which TEP is allowed to share among everybody. They have to make sure that this is protected and only exposed to officials or to users which are entitled to get access to this information. And in the red part, it's an example for the sensitive personal information. It's about a user's or a person's sex, age, religion, about physical handicaps and something like that. This is even more sensitive, and there are even higher protection measures on this kind of data. Well, when we talk about the granularity about, of the authorization, which has to take place, this is down to attribute level. So we have features, pipeline features, something like that, relations among features, these features shall be shared to anybody, maybe, but these features also might include attributes which are sensitive or which are just personal and cannot be shared. We have, let's say, first of all, access control to different services or different applications or different kinds of information. Then we have access control on certain layers of information, but even we have access control on certain features, but even on sub-feature level, on attribute level, we need something like access control in order to enforce the security requirements in here. So, for instance, all contractors shall be able to see the pipeline features, but they only shall be able to see work status information on their own work, not on the work of other contractors and competitors, for instance. Everybody shall be able to see the parcel information, but not the owner information, who's the owner of a certain parcel, or how much compensation did he get paid, something like that. This is has to be protected. And country officials, for instance, can see owner identity of parcels, but also not the compensations which are paid, because this is not a public business. This is negotiated between TAP and the owners, and that isn't something the officials need to get access to. When we look at the example, so this is an information system about the different or about the parcels which are touched by the pipeline, and this is an example about all the information which is available for a certain feature. So this is an example without any kind of restriction, so you can see anything. So this is the view of a let's say high privileged user within TAP. There are users which are able to, or who are able to get access to all of the data, but this is just one user group, and there are others as well. So, and then you see this is the access control system, and on the lower part, there are three different policies. Policies for full access, policies which filters only the sensitive personal information, and another policy which filters all personal and sensitive personal information. So for the different classes of protection, there are three different policies in there. And when we look into such a policy, there's a kind of attribute restrictions which is defined, and then you can check the certain attributes which shall be denied for a certain role or for a certain group of people. And the result of it looks like this. It's the same information system, but it's accessed by a different user. And this different user then has also different access rights and different access level. And therefore, the amount of information shrinks just to the set of information which shall be visible for this actual user. In classical systems where no access control is applied, people tend to set up, let's say, individual services for the different kinds of users. As long as we are talking about three different levels of authorization, that might be feasible. So we could also set up three different services, one including all information, one including information without the sensitive data, and one including information without the personal data. But if you think about policies like let contractors only see their own parts of the building process, that would mean you would have to set up services for each contractor, and that's becoming, let's say, quite a mess of administration, and therefore TAP is setting up services only once with the full information available, and then creating access policies in order to reflect the different access permissions for the different users.
Can you start wrapping up?
Yes. In order to wrap up, let's have a look on how the architecture looks like. So we have applications on the left-hand side, we have the access control system in the middle, and we have the server side on the right-hand side. And for each request which is coming in, two different aspects have to be fulfilled. First, users have to be authenticated in order to know who that user is. And then according to the user's identity, the authorization has to take place. So this is all handled by this security manager component in the middle. That fits very well into the TAP philosophy of, let's say, systems they would like to use in their in their enterprise. They have a strong preference on commercial off the shelf software because it's for them. It's the most easiest way to maintain their system and to support their system. And when using this kind of access control system, that pretty much fits into this commercial off the shelf layer in there. So that's it. Thank you for your interest. And if you have further questions, you can also visit me at our booth and we can talk about these issues as well.
Thank you, Rüdiger. Question for Rüdiger? At some point, somebody has to ask a question. Is it now? No, it's later. Obviously, that was not a whole lot about Inspire, which is not a point, but no. I can see that there will also be data which you have to make available, and we talk about licensing in the Inspire context, and I think in projects like ELF, access management is also an issue, so I understand this as one example how you can, in an intelligent way, do this access management. Huh? Okay, thanks again. We continue. We have still three presentations to go. The next presentation is from Juan Maso. He's a researcher at the Center for Ecology, Research and Forestry in a town in Spain, which is not specified, but I'm sure, it's you. You are going to tell us.
Well, I work in CREAF in an institute near to Barcelona. And since I'm not able to be to stand still, I'm using this mic also. Well, this is a work that we did in the Institut Cartographic and Geologic de Catalunya, but we think that has a general value, and for that reason we are here presenting it. I'm working on that green tree, CREAF, and my name is Joan Masó, as you say. So we have been fighting to collect digital information for quite a while, and I think that now we are starting, you know, seeing sessions about big data and big data management and so on. So maybe we are in good shape on some aspects at least. So we are starting to detect the interest of the data preservation topic. The reason is that data sets will be here in Inspire reviewed and maintained continuously in a way that there is a risk of losing temporal series. And that could be crucial to analyze the continuous human impact into the planet and in Europe, and also to monitor the effectiveness of the European Union policies over the time. So I think that that's really important. We start thinking about how we are going to preserve data and how much data we are going to present and so far. Data preservation is more challenging than, let's say, digital data preservation is more challenging than, let's say, paper presentation. But anyway, it has been considered in several domains, but there is no standardized model to do that in the geospatial world that has global acceptance yet. So there is room for that. As I said, in collaboration with the Institut Cartographic de Geologic de Catalunya, and in particular with Dolors, that's there, that will tell you more about the context of this work. I'm going to talk just about the specificities of this first step that we did, that's establishing a digital preservation metadata model that allows documenting the relevant and necessary features to ensure the durability of the information. Of course, we are in the context of the ISO and OGC standards, so we want to use the current common metadata standards that we all know, and I will not mention yet. So first thing we did was to look at the literature and what people are doing here and there, and which standards are out there to do this thing. One of the most commonly used standard is the Open Archival Information System, OAIS. It is a reference standard in the for preservation of digital information. Is prepared by the Consultative Committee of Space Data Systems, and from ISO also. And as I said, it's a reference model, so it's a document full of these kind of boxes that you see here, so-called UML. So it's a conceptual model, though it doesn't indicate how to implement it or which are the nitty-gritty details about attributes and values that you have to take care of. From it we found the idea of preservation package. We also used the classification in large, let's say, conceptual containers, and that we are following. We saw the structure of collections and units that's useful for geospatial series, and we ensured that what we were going to do was conformant to this framework. Premise data dictionary is another thing that we look at. It's develops a proposed core set for preservation metadata applicable to a wide range of things, not just geospatial. And there is a guidelines and recommendations for the creation and maintenance and use of preservation metadata. The model defines five different entities as the most important thing, defines ways to relate them. And this is what we saw important, and this is what we take. From the GeoMap is a special multi-scale archival and presentation partnership. Well, there is these archival metadata elements for preservation of geospatial data sets. It implements a metadata model, great, that's exactly what we need, but unfortunately, even if it's quite detailed, it uses the American metadata standard, let's say that, the so-called federal standard. So, well, we have to work with it if we want to adopt it. From this, we are taking the preservation strategy, the value, and the justification of for presentation that are concepts that are really needed. Also, we have a context there in Catalonia for preservation of administrative documents and so on. There is a commission that has to evaluate which things has to be preserved and which not. And they have kind of a form that you have to submit to them in order to know if your data is valuable for being preserved in the administrative workflow, they say that, let's say that. So when you fill the form, in fact, you are providing metadata. So in essence, it's also a metadata, you know, template. Let's not call it a standard, but at least a template. They make a lot of emphasis in the justification and the value of the data again. So this is a thing that we are seeing recurrently. Well, there are other many things that I can continue enumerating, but you know, the chairman is very strict with the time, so I will not do that. And I will go directly to the step two, model design. So, as I said, ISO 115 metadata model is our starting point. In order to communicate better our model, we use the UML representation of the classes and so on, and all these boxes. And we were fortunate because, you know, those ISO models are maintained at CSIRO repository. In Australia, I don't know why in Australia, but they are there. We simply download the Enterprise Architect UML model, and we start working with it, even with the same file, just adding, extending the preservation concepts that we want to add. And this way, we are sure that we are maintaining the link with the ISO 115-1 models. What's the reason of using 1.5-1? Well, that's the new standard. I don't know how many implementations we have seen so far, but there are many things that have been improved in that model. So we prefer that because they are beneficial, particularly the treatment of identifiers or citations is one thing that we needed, and it's completely fixed, I think, there. Also, it's relatively backwards compatible, so it is not so difficult to migrate one metadata record that you have to the -1 version. Okay, so we have all these different standards, and we want to merge them in the preservation model. As I said, we are basing on this one, and if possible, we don't want to overkill this thing. So giving recommendation of how to use different elements here is a preferred strategy, or even recycling classes. If I need some kind of archival info, I will base that on distribution info, for instance. This has a drawback. My preservation information model will be scattered around the ISO 1.5. But unfortunately, there is this concept of the preservation package that will help me to re-centralize every thing. Only when something is really absolutely not in the standard, we are going to add a new concept. So this is how the model looks like. It's very far away, so you don't see anything. These are the new additions that we needed. So this is preservation actions, value, use and justification, relations between resources, the preservation package, and the acquisition process are things that we have added. And I will not present each of them, just two details. In order to be on time. This is how we are describing the preservation package. The preservation package is kind of a, you collect everything, every file, every bit of information that is related with your data set, and you put it together in kind of a basket, and you keep it there. It's like making a zip file. Maybe you will never do the actual act of zipping it, but at least you need links to everything. So here you see the description of the package, and you see the description of each element of the package with the format, the name of the thing, the data type, and so on. We base this on the GeoMap for describing the formats that are incorporated, that are a little bit down there. The value and the justification of the strategy. So we need to kind of a way to measure the value of the data. This is more important because, you know, we are not talking here about archiving, we are talking about preserving. And when you preserve, you select. And you know that you do that regularly, even at home, where you first you archive, your knowledge in school and so on, everything is archived, but one day you select. And that's what you really preserve, what you think that has some kind of a value. So here we have value information, and this value could be administrative, could be legal, could be evidence, CRE, could be research, could be informational, historical. Apart from saying that there is a value here, you have to provide some kind of a justification. Then somebody will, maybe some authority will reveal that. So you have here the preservation review and the date of this review and the reasons and the decisions. And someday you will finally remove this item. Maybe not, but maybe yes. So you have also the capability to decide about the preservation and to remove the item. Okay, the value is also about the usage. So you really need to be convinced that the thing is used. So I don't know if you remember in the ISO model, there is a thing that is called usage that allows you to document who and when and how your data was used. Nobody really is using that, but it's very interesting.
I really hope that we will start using that in the future. I'm extending this thing into a service identification in order to save metrics about usage of services that were based on this data.
That's it.
Step three, going into practice.
This is not just a theoretical exercise. We went to,
you know, real data set, not a photographic data set, an example, and we, you know, we start working with it. So first thing, as I said, UML model in ISO, our UML preservation extension, we used an application that is called ShapeChange to transform this UML into XML. This is giving us an XML schema thing. And then on the other hand, this is the real example, an orthophoto description, and we go from 115 to 115-1 with an automatic transformation, XSL, and then we edit it with the preservation items that rely on those schemas, and finally we have another XSL thing to have a more human representation of this.
Let me just emphasize that I really love the ShapeChange application.
It really allows you to remove complexity. You think UML, you think about the model, and then you press a button, and in theory, you get an XML. Not always, but if it not, it's your fault. So you fix it and you go around again.
And I also
I'm also pleased to be able to to have kind of a connection with Ted Heberman. So we had access to the XML schemas that are not available yet, and that's one of the reasons nobody is using 115-1 ready. So we used that, and we used also the XSL transformation that's out there. By the way, these schemas are not secret anymore. They are on GitHub, so you can definitely take a look.
And this is how it looks like in the end. And I will describe each of those lines. Of course I will not.
just to say that after transforming this into the human XML, HTML presentation, here is the package information, and you see a general package description, and then you see elements. Here are called components that are files that compose
your package.
And this is another example about context information. This is a thing that I am doing because this is an example of a thing I haven't explained, but nevertheless is this way of linking resources. And here I'm linking the orthophotographic product with the topographic product.
So in conclusion, we have defined a model that adopts the ISO 115-1 and makes minimal extensions to cover data preservation needs. The model has been tested with real examples, and since we detected that need, we want to continue working on that, maybe participating or even influence the new data preservation standard that will be called 19165. By the way, there is a meeting in 2 weeks in Southampton that could be crucial for the development of this, because this is really at the beginning of the process. So it's the right time to influence the direction of the stand. Also to reinvigorate the data preservation group that was a bit dormant in OGC. Of course, contributing to the preservation subgroup of the Catalonia Cartographic Roadmap, the Pla Cartographic de Catalunya, and continue collaborating with the Institut Cartographic i Geològic de Catalunya with the implementation of this stuff. So thank you.
Thank you, Johan. That was very interesting to learn about also the difference between archiving and preserving. I was not so well aware of this distinction, but it seems to become relevant as we get more and more data all over. Option for questions?
I will yes.
I will save you.
Oh, go.
So your data model for presentation is based on different standards. Mm-hmm. Each of them could have a version. So somehow it could have an impact on the versioning of your presentation, and that could have a strong impact in the versioning of the presentation. And I was thinking, maybe then you run the risk that you have to preserve the data that are going to be used to preserve the metadata that are going to be used to preserve the data, which becomes a bit, in my opinion, complex scenario.
Okay.
Isn't it?
That's a fair comment, of course. There are several things to answer to that. One, the first thing is that we are kind of looking at those standards, but we are not importing things, just looking for ideas and grabbing things to try to be complete. But nevertheless, that's a good comment. We have to preserve data and metadata. Of course, we have. And the group, the ISO group, has that in the name. So they are calling themselves data and metadata preservation. Versioning could be really, really, really a problem. And this is part of the preservation problem in itself. I'm anticipating some of my colleague comments, but you know, one of the things that is complicated is preserve a thing when you know that the technology is going to evolve. So maybe you have the risk that you lose track of your application and you are not able to open that fascinating package that I presented just because the technology is so old. So preservation is not just a story. There is a processing thing also that has to allow you to maintain the data and in some sense also to update versions and so on. That's part of a different thing. Here we just talk about which metadata we need, but this is part of the biggest context that we have to continue work together.
Okay, thanks a lot. Thanks a lot, Joan. We have the next presentation by Dolores Barofischak, head of unit in the Cartography and Geological Institute in Barcelona of Catalonia. So, Dolores, you will tell us about, I guess, a particular application of this work in your institute.
Okay. Thank you very much for your introduction. I try to do my best. I have no more voice. If there is any problem, please ask and I repeat anytime that is necessary. Okay. I am coming from the Cartographic and Geological Institute of Catalonia. Since our creation in 1992, we were focused in the transformation of the traditional analog processes in the digital ones. We thought that it would be more efficient in order to produce geographical information. We started with the production processes, the restitution, the generating ortho images. After that, we follow with the aerial triangulation, and after that, with the data capture, with digital images, and so on. And now we are in the process that the end of the process, the product, the final product is also digital. And then that is when we realize that all paper products, we had the obligation to deliver one copy to our map library, okay? But with the digital one, we forgot it. More or less, in a joke or something like that, you could say a user could go to the map library of Catalonia. They can access, consult, and look up, analyze, and whatever, paper map from the 19th century. But it's really, really difficult for them to analyze, study, or to deal with our digital data from the 90s or the 20s at the beginning, okay? And this is, okay, we are a mapping agency. We are not someone who produces a map for a project and we forgot the map. We think that it's our obligation to preserve this kind of digital information. And then I will show in my presentation a little bit the current situation where we are and the preservation project that we have started in 2 years ago. I will talk about the general issues about the current situation that are common for not only specific geographic information, also for digital information, someone specific related with our obligations, legal obligations, and after that I will talk about the preservation project. The current situation, as Joan started telling a little bit about it, we think that we have to preserve three different kinds of things. In a digital, digital data are registered in a digital support, a digital, sorry, in a media, and we need to preserve this media. Physically, we need to avoid being damaged, a tape or a disk or a floppy or whatever. But we need also, we can preserve the support or the media, but if we don't have the peripheral to read this media, it's nonsense to preserve the media. Then we need to preserve not only the support, also the hardware and the a certain kind of software of to communicate with this media or support. But there is not only the one we need to take care of. This is a real example. I prepared a PowerPoint in 1997, and when I tried to reopen in 2005, the PowerPoint, the Microsoft application said, it's not a PowerPoint. I knew it was because I did it, I wrote it, but this is the result. I couldn't open the file. This is a useless, well, it's not important because there is nothing crucial in my PowerPoint, but it could happen the same in our data, geographical data, which are made in commercial softwares. And if we are not taking care of how evolved this commercial software, probably from, I don't know, 30 years later, we are not able to open. We have preserved the bit or the byte, but we are not preserving the information, okay? A part of that, we need to take care of what is the geographic information. From our point of view, we have products which are static. Some of them are digitalization of analog documents. In our map library, which is becoming a digital map library, is quite, well, it's an important job to digitalize any of the ancient maps that we have, and we can check it, and our customers could consult or users through the web page. But it's not crucial to lose the digital data because we preserve the original analog one. Then it's not critical. But with the products we are producing recently, they are digital, and they have some specific characteristics related with its nature digital. Interoperability, dimensions, if there are three dimensionals or four or five, or ortho images, not only the panchromatic or the visual infrared, there are other kind of channels. And if we not take care of that, we have the risk of lose this part of information. Other difficult to add it. Nowadays, we are dealing with dynamic databases. And this is something that has we started working this related with Inspire. Inspire introduces the life cycle of data of objects, and we thought, okay, we are updating continuously. Maybe if we introduce this data life cycle in our model, we can have a database dynamic, but also the historical data are inside of our database. We need to preserve this database, maybe not at any change or any updated data, but maybe once a year or twice a year, or what you need to consider important for your users or whatever, okay? But nowadays appear another problem. We have distributed our data like services, through web services, and now the product is not the main product. It's a combination of different products, some of them more than one from the IIST, the Cartographic and Geological Institute, but some of them combining the user own data or a department of the administration with their own data and our data as a background or something related with our data. What we need to preserve? our data, the data of the other department, both combined in, we need to preserve twice. We have no answers nowadays. We start with the analysis of the situation, and we start with the first and second steps, the product. We need to talk and discuss a little bit more about the dynamic and services. Okay. This is how we are evolving from the technological department. They are really focused on the technological evolutions, and we have changed our IT department or IT hardware in a different way in order to use media with high capacity. And then we have some added problem. The data are growing exponentially, more or less. Then we need to work a little bit with that. Okay, this is one of the solutions we have made. Our IT department is working quite well, and they have a change of media each 5-6 years, more or less. This is the life cycle of the media linear tape open four, who appears in 2007. We start with this LTO4 in 2009, and they are three kind of data. The blue one is the preserved, but not in the real sense of preservation, stored, archival, whatever you want. The green is the new data we produce each year, and the red ones, they are the migration of the data in other support to migrate the new one. At 2004, this is the whole data that we have in this support. We are able to read, to open, and so on. And now we are trying to move to a new linear tape open 6. And, well, the process starts again. We have solved this migration problem. The transformation, trying to eliminate the obsolescence of the formats or versions, we are not dealing with that subject at that moment. But it's something we need to have. Regarding the life cycle of data, as I said before, we storage by accumulation. Our organization have not classification or protocols to classify and organize and store the information. It depends on the people in charge of the processes. That means the name files, the way to group the files, the metadata they are writing associated with these files, the documents associated with these files, or the time this information should be stored, it depends on the people in charge. Could be that some data are duplicated because the images, for example, are used in the topographic processes and the ortho image processes, and we have the risk to have duplicated this data. The information is cataloged, but from the IT department. That means they could find any of the files stored in the tapes or in the media that we have at that moment. But it's difficult for someone who is not who ordered the storage of this data to know what is inside this data. That means the capacity of finding and understanding information is sensitive to the staff changes. And finally, the accessibility of those data is limited. Internally, all the information is available, of course, but I have no idea how many days I need to find one specific data I am looking for. If I preserve this data, I order to store this data, it's easy for me to find it. But if I am not stored this data, it's quite difficult. Probably at the end I will find, but I don't know how many times I need. And externally, we are distributing our current products in several formats, conscious of this situation, we try to recover the historical data and distribute it through view services, visualization mainly. As a legal obligations, we are responsible for the Map Library of Catalonia, and we have the legal obligation to preserve and disseminate analog and digital information. In the Map Library, there is a plot, we scan this plot and we consult in the Map Library, not in the web page from the institution. In the Map Library, yes, but not as a cartographic institute. Ortho images, for example, the first version, It was printed out, and then we scanned the printout, and we have these copies in as a web service, and you can look up. It's scan images. What that means? There is the images and the geographical names over the images. But if you are able to recover the original ortho images, we distribute it through web services, but we have not able to recover the map names used to put on these versions of the topographic data. Ortho images, sorry. There is images, in that case, without map names. Well, this is the situation that we have at that moment. We are more responsible, more legal obligations for certain data sets of the cartographic plan of Catalonia, but this is supposed to be the geographical information needed for the development of the region. And this information should be preserved according to the criteria or policies that the Cartographic Coordination Commission of Catalonia, but these policies have not written or dictated. Then we need to give support. Well, we have the responsibility of giving support to this coordination committee, and then we think that it's important to provide some ideas for dictating these policies. The project. We start the project with an audit, internal audit, and the results are mainly what I have said in the current situation. We have an infrastructure from the IT department point of view quite well dimensioned, and we are ready to preserve the data independent of the media, but we have not a strategic plan. We don't know who is the future users for this kind of data we are preserving, or we are storing, archiving in our servers. Okay? We need two criteria to select data to be preserved, long-term preserved. 1 year, 10 years, 100 years. It depends on the uses that we have, we can imagine for this kind of data. And then establish the preservation workflows to create the metadata of preservation, to link with the package of information who will be preserved, and then to start all these processes. Okay. This is the roadmap we plan. 4 phases. Design, we are here. Implementation, this is the next step. To build a trustworthy repository, that means to validate and to certificate this repository of information preserved. And then to determine which are the dissemination information packages related with the designing communities. The users could mark which kind of information we want to distribute in the future. Okay. And this is where we are. We create an internal working team, obviously led by the map library, who is the department who distribute or provide access to this historical information. The IT department, of course, and the databases, the departments who produce the databases for geological information. We started the study of the metadata, for instance, in 2 production lines. These lines are certified ISO 9001, and that means they are well documented and could be a very nice thing for Joan in order to make a better proposal. At least the information was quite well described, okay? And now, we ask to the people or the producers of geographical information in Catalonia to make their own analysis of the data according to the levels of digital preservation provided by the National Digital Stewardship Alliance or something like that. I don't remember exactly the name. I could send you if you like. Okay. Following the ISO related with the preservation of digital data and metadata who start their work in the next month, working in the selection criteria, what to preserve in the current production lines, and definition of the submission information package to be preserved. This is the first step. And then how we upgrade or modify these packages in order to be accessible in the future. But one important thing to be taken into account, this process should be sustainable. We are not resources yes. for preserve anything, and we need to be conscious of that. And thank you very much for your attention. That's all.
Thank you very much, Dolores. So we see how much effort this takes to put this into practice. It's good research work and standardization work. Are we having a question from the audience? I mean, we had our question, but we could have another one. No, I don't have a question this time around. Thank you very much. We are looking forward to the last presentation of the day, and the last presentation is by Marlene Antunes. Antunes? Marlene comes from the Azores, which is, I think, the part of Europe which is most close to America. So we are curious to hear what you are doing on the Azores in the context of GIS and Inspire. And yeah. But the presentation is not there.
Technical problems, just 1 minute. I have not been. It should be fine.
I can maybe ask a question to Dolores still. Can I ask a question? With all this work, I mean, you will have quite an archive of data. I mean, you were on one of the slides, you were showing that this new way of preserving / archiving data, you want to apply it to the data from after 2008 or so, something like that. How much time is this going to take you? You are now putting in place your plan, I understand, and then you have to do the work on all these, for example, web mapping services and so on, and all these work.
Images in the original format, but we are not able to recover the magnetic report of the map we distributed. And now we prefer to distribute. Now that you can check in our web page, all the images we have produced in 1992 till now.
Oh.
If I understand your question correctly, the intention was not go back to the archive and metadata everything and apply the new strategy. The new strategy will be applied to the future.
Yeah. Only to the future.
Only to the future. Because, as you say, it's tremendously difficult.
Yeah.
I mean, time, hours to do it for the current.
For the archive, all data we're trying to
Thank you. So Marlene is using this nice new technology of Prezi, which, as we can see, can be challenging to the presenter. But I think it's a very nice way of visualizing. Please go ahead.
Well, good afternoon. As you all know by now, I come from the Azorean region. We have our 9 islands in there in the display, divided in 3 groups, and it also shows how. All the institutions work within Azores because we have a wide range of geographical range And the institutions, public institutions also are in those places. So different institutions are in different islands, and so it's quite difficult sometimes so that that we can speak all the same language, even though we are in the same region. Okay, I will talk about GEMA. That is the application that the Azores developed to create and edit metadata. And I will speak a little bit how did GEMA appear, what are GEMA's main features, relating GEMA with the Azorean metadata system, and of course INSPIRE, and a little about the conclusions of our work and our future hopes. How did GEMA appear? There are some points that need to be pointed. And first of all, there was a regional law that implemented the regional infrastructure of spatial data, IDEA. And with that regional law, it was also implemented the regional metadata system, SMA. And also, at the same time, there was the implementation of the regional metadata profile. Of course, this profile had to be in line with the national profile, with Portuguese profile relating metadata, and of course with INSPIRE regulations and requirements. So due all to those reasons, it was necessary in Azores, because there was practically nothing happening relating to metadata and Azores at the time, it was established that there would be an Azorean metadata editor. And so that could cover all this, for me, left side. and we could all, in Azores region, have one application that could serve all entities, all public entities at least, so that metadata could be formatted the same, and to be exchanged and with everybody that would intend to create metadata and work with informatics in the geographical information. So I will talk about GEMA's main features. There are a few. Of course, we need to create metadata. We need to create the files. This is in Portuguese, I'm sorry. but we have several buttons within the application after it's downloaded. And the first one, of course, is always to create metadata file. So that's what we intend to show here. We have some examples of metadata that were already created. And it creates an XML file at the beginning of the work with the application. After we create the metadata file, we need to edit, we need to input information with the metadata file. And so it is a quite friendly application to use. Mandatory fields are indicated with that red dot so that the user can know what the mandatory files are within INSPIRE. And many of them are already a little, we help the user to fill the I'm sorry, I'm missing the field. I was missing the word. With the help, and we also have a guide that helps the user to follow the user within the editing of the meta file. There is one special thing we think. It's our vision, that we can select active validation. and that active validation shows the user when it's filling the metadata fields, if they are being well filled, or and if there is any field that's mandatory and is not being filled. So the user will be warned automatically if anything doesn't work properly. After all is done and all is edited and all is checked, we want to save our files. We can save our files locally in our computer. And if you are an Azorean entity, an Azorean public entity, you can also, and we try to do that, that the metadata files are saved within that entity area that is saved up in the regional metadata system. You can save the files in XML format or PDF format. Sometimes entities want to share their metadata in a user-friendly viewing and not those XML format and view. And so we give that opportunity to the user so that they can save in PDF format. It's nicer, okay? It's, it's a little better and it's easier to someone that does not know much about the data, that can read much easier about the information that is there. You can also view the files that you have created or other files that come to you and are created with Gemma. You can view in XML or HTML format. This HTML format that you see is very similar to the PDF format that you can get the files. It's friendlier to it's not more organized because the information is the same, but it's organized in a different way so that it's easier for the user to understand what it is there. As I said, during the filling of the fields, you can activate the validation, but if you want to submit the files, the metadata file into our system, you need the system runs a validation. And if something does not work, it will warn you and tell you that is not possible to submit, which was the case. And that this user should fill all the mandatory files. In here we have an example that a mandatory file that was not correctly filled. When the fields are not okay, they are formatted and highlighted with red so that it shows off right away that something is not right. After this validation, you can submit the files. And when you click that submit that is highlighted, you are submitting the files to the Azorean metadata system. After this submission, you wait just a little that the system and the system administrator rapidly, hopefully, checks if everything is okay and then accepts the metadata file. If you don't want to submit the files, you can save them or you can just keep them there for after editing. But if you submit, you will get an information that it was received and also approved if that's the case. Those buttons after the submit are buttons only for the administration. The administration, the system administration can cancel the submission, can accept the submission, can reprove if anything is not working very well. We say you can't submit with that button. Okay. So GMA and the system and the Zorian metadata system is when you submit, I told you that you would get to the file will be inserted into the Zorian metadata system. And then it can be discovered. You can find the metadata, you can find the information that is already been metadata for in the original system. Right now we have information about many from many Azorian entities and some national entities that try to submit also metadata into our regional metadata system. I will show you, if I have the time, a little how this research and how this discovery functions. Of course, that not everybody can submit metadata into our system. Because this was a regional system, there was the first idea, it was to have the regional entities, public entities, publishing and creating metadata. And so every single authority within the Azorian government has a metadata manager that is the responsible to create and to submit the metadata for that entity. And so if something is wrong, we know exactly who to contact, and of course they know who contact in our site. So we try to create some connections and some close, keep close touch with the entity so that we can help them creating the metadata and to insert the metadata and to have, of course, more metadata about the Azores. That's the whole point of having this system. Of course, as I explained, GEMA and Inspire, we have GEMA in the Azores creating metadata, Inspire with the Inspire rules and implementations. Of course, these metadata go to the national repository. In Portugal, there are other metadata applications. I only put one in here that was more used. That was MIG. And then, of course, it goes to the Inspire catalog through the Portuguese national institution so that can integrate all the Inspire catalog so that it can be, all metadata can be discovered also at Inspire level. And of course, all metadata are Inspire compilants. Okay, I'm finishing. What do we would like? We'd like to improve towards Inspire rules. We also would like to improve the application itself because we speak with the users very closely. Sometimes they ask some things and we try to make the changes so that we go to their requests. It happens sometimes. We also find sometimes things that we think we can improve, and we try to improve all the time the application. Of course, have more entities creating metadata. Many of the municipalities in Azores are already creating metadata also, but we need to reach all of them, all the public enterprises also, and if possible, some enterprises, local enterprises that manage geographic information that produce Azorian information. And who knows, maybe we have been having some indication towards that GEMA could be the national metadata editor. So we hope we can get there. We are trying to do that, and it would be very good for us because it was a sign of good work and well done. to download GMR. You can go to that link. I hope there is internet so that I can show you now. If there isn't internet, at least you have the link. Otherwise, if you go to ideia.azur.gov.pt and you go to metadata.
I don't think we should go into, because we used our time, I don't think we should go into detailed internet presentations.
No, it was only to,
we keep
to
seeing that this may be dangerous also, that it doesn't fully work. So
so it was everything I had to show you. I hope you enjoyed it. Thank you so much for your attention.
Thank you very much, Marlene. And I think the organizers, they will provide all the presentations at some place on the internet so that you do not have to write down this links here. And you can probably Google it as well in some way or another.
Yes.
So have you got a question? Yes, Juan?
I mentioned in my presentation the ISO 115-1 and the corresponding encoding 115-3. Do you have plans for that? Are you scared of having to, you know, recode?
I don't think we are scared. Otherwise, we would not have tried to do this. So, but we have to study and to see the implications of this of that implementation. So, we need to study it before we change what is done, so that. Everything is well done.
If you allow me another one,
yeah.
Do you think or do you support extensions? So imagine my preservation extension.
Not right now.
Not right.
No, not right now.
I'm also curious because apparently you are. I mean, first of all, I mean you. Are there no other metadata editors in Portugal? How is the Inspire metadata being provided then? Because I know Portugal is keen and you do the reporting as you showed also to the European level. So there must be a national system.
Yes,
and then there's also, for example, why did you have to develop your own metadata editor?
It was mainly because there was that regional law implemented the regional infrastructure and the system. And when we started to create metadata with the existing applications, something was missing for us.
Uh-huh.
And so we tried to personalize and to give our entities a way that some fields could be partially formed relating directly to Azores. And then things were evolving and we started to develop the application and when we saw the national institution was using our application also, so but mainly because the implementation of the end of the decree.
And this is built on what technically? For example, we have a lot of open source tools like GeoNetwork, which you could also customize, let's say. Yeah?
This was in .NET, but the regional government has the source is owned by the government, and so if the nationalizing of GEMA goes forward, of course we will give that the source to the national entity so that it can be spread out.
Okay, that looked very nice. Thank you very much to you. Thank you very much to the entire audience for keeping your breath and staying along. I think the weather is nice outside. Whatever you like to do now, please enjoy the rest of the day. Good afternoon.
Good afternoon.